Summary of Canto 1, Balakanda. This is based on, this is actually a translation. This is based on a translation of Sri Narayana Panditacharya's Sangraha Ramayana. This is a famous book in the Madhva circles. Narayana Pandita was the son of Trivikrama Panditacharya, who was a famous disciple of Madhvacharya. And Narayana Pandita also wrote some important books. He is famous for his biography of Madhvacharya, known as Sumadhva Vijaya or Srimadhva Vijaya. So, as a canto summary, we are presenting an English translation of his work. He begins by offering his respectful obeisances unto the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Narayana, who is the worshipable Supreme Brahman. And then he offers his obeisances unto Hanuman, unto Bhima, unto Madhvacharya, and unto his spiritual master. Then he invokes the blessings of Sri Valmiki. And then he begins to say that in the beginning, there was only Lord Narayana. He was happy with Lakshmi. And the Upanishads glorified the Supreme Lord, as we know from the prayers of the personified Vedas in the Krishna book, 10th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. Then the Supreme Lord desired to engage in the activity of creation, of providing the living entities with bodies according to their karmic reactions. So the Supreme Lord, he united with his internal potency, and he expanded himself into various forms. And as he expanded into various forms, those his internal potency also expanded into various forms. Just as he expands into Sankarsana, Pradyumna, Niruddha, then Lakshmi also expands into various forms. She assumes various names, as we learn from the scriptures. So in this way, he has innumerable forms. Even though he is one, he is unlimited. He possesses unlimited qualities, and all these qualities are non-different from him. He does not possess any distress, nor is he destroyed. He is not dependent on anyone else, does not take birth, and so on. How do we know this? We know this from the Pancharatra, from the Brahmatarka, from the Puranas, the Itihasas, the Upanishads, the Vedanta Sutra, and the four Vedas themselves. So the Supreme Lord just initiates the process of creation, and then he agitates the three modes of material nature, and he activates Pradhana. And then as things develop, as we learn from the third canto of Srimad Bhagavatam also, the elements begin to form, and with their presiding deities, they take shelter of the Supreme Lord Vishnu. Then the Lord, out of his mercy, he creates this Brahmanda as a place of residence for those elements. He then creates the creator, Lord Brahma. Then Brahma creates the Devas, Danavas, and so on, and human beings. When Brahma created the four Kumaras, they refused to participate in the activity of creation. Then Brahma became angry. And from Brahma's forehead appeared Rudra. Rudra is a predominating deity of false ego. Then, from Brahma, the sages headed by Marichi were born. From Marichi, Kashyapa. From Kashyapa and Aditi, Vivaswan. From Vivaswan, Shraddha Deva Manu was born. In his dynasty, there were very nice kings like Ikshvaku. Amongst those kings, the most brilliant of them was King Dasharatha. He resided in the famous city Ayodhya, and he protected the earth of seven islands with a single royal flag. When he maintained the earth, the four principles of Dharma, Artha, Kama, Moksha were properly dealt with. He had only one defect. He did not have a son. But nevertheless, he pleased his citizens very much. So they did not experience any defect because of him not having a son. But he was filled with anxiety, just as a Mimamsaka trying to understand the purport of the Veda becomes filled with anxiety when he does not understand the nature of reality by studying the three Vedas. The king called Sumantra and other ministers and told, "I would like to perform the Ashwamedha Yajna to please the Supreme Lord Vishnu in order to obtain some sons. If the Lord is happy, what cannot be achieved? O Sumantra, please bring the sacrificial performers, the officiating priests, and our Guru Vasishtha." Sumantra did as he was ordered. Then the king repeatedly bowed down to them with deep humility and devotion while remembering Lord Vasudeva in his heart. Suyagya, Vamadeva, Jabali, Kashyapa, and Vasishtha were five brahmanas who shone in King Dasharatha's palace. They unanimously gave permission for conducting Ashwamedha Yajna. The king then had the ingredients for the Ashwamedha sacrifice gathered. Then Sumantra met him in privacy and told him that the very powerful Sanat Kumara had already mentioned in an assembly of sages the following: Kashyapa's grandson named Rishyashringa will bring about rain in the country named Anga. The king of Anga will then give his daughter Shanta in marriage to Rishyashringa. A king named Dasharatha will bring the sage to his kingdom and have him conduct a sacrifice, and the Supreme Lord Vishnu will become his son Rama and make the entire world happy. Sumantra then told King Dasharatha, "So invite this sage from Anga." With Vasishtha's permission, Dasharatha personally went and brought Rishyashringa. By this time, the sacrificial horse had already circumambulated the earth. The king was initiated into a fire sacrifice on the northern bank of Sarayu, and several kings and various citizens, they came, and Dasharatha had massive distribution of Yajna Prasada. The Ashwamedha Yajna was conducted with great expertise by Rishyashringa and Vasishtha and their assistants. Vayu and other demigods were delighted by these performances. After all, the sponsor was Dasharatha. The performer was Brahma's son Vasishtha. And the result was the appearance of Lord Ramachandra. Dasharatha gave charity abundantly to the priests. And then he gave in charity to others also. Because he was so devoted to genuine Brahmanas, the entire population worshipped King Dasharatha. The Brahmanas very happily gave him their blessings. The sage Rishyashringa performed the Ishti sacrifice to purify, and then he called for the demigods who had arrived with Indra for their share of the oblation. Then he told them that please be satisfied with this king. He desires to have very nice sons. Some work has to be done for the demigods. So please permit this. When Rishyasringa solicited them in this manner on behalf of the king, the demigods granted him a benediction and then went to beseech Lord Brahma.